WRGW, Washington, D.C.
I went sinking last night. You took my phone away, stole my fight. To take my teeth from under my pillowcase and ride like this was nice.
Hey, this is Emily Yarmchuk from Massey. Give our new single, Lost Mary, a spin, and you are listening to WRGW District Radio.
Want to get a spot with us real quick? Something like, hey, I'm Max's dad, and you're listening to WRGW.
District Radio?
Yeah, District Radio. That's great. Right. There you go.
Okay. Hey, I'm Max's dad, and you're listening to WRGW District Radio.
That's perfect.
Good. That was so good.
That was my silly announcer. Max, I'll see you soon. I love you.
See you soon. Love you, too. Thanks for calling in, Dad.
Bye.
Bye, guys.
Okay, we've all gone too big too fast and then run out of room. We've all made
it. W-R-G-W.
Sign. You get that poster board up and you're like, I don't need to trace it. I know how big letters should be. But to begin with, a big
W.
Followed by a big
R.
And oh no. Oh God. Okay, all right. Real skinny.
G.
With a high hump. With a high hump, and then we'll put the second
W
below the hump of that first
G.
Sort of like a motorcycle sidecar situation. Block letters and cursive look good together. And then you go to write
District Radio.
And you totally forget the lesson you just learned with
W-R-G-W.
You're like, yeah, but the past is the past. Surely more letters will fit in the same space.
W-R-G-W.
How old are you? You're 13, perfect age. You'll be sitting there, and you go, look at me, I'm 13, and I love
WRGW District Radio.
Hi, I'm Gabby from DAFO.
Wait, yeah.
What do I, like... you can hear me on WRGW.
I think we're all waiting for the district radio, but that's good.
Okay, I can redo it.
Do it again.
Okay,
yeah.
Okay,
you can
just
feel like
and you're listening to.
Hi, I'm Gabby from DAFO, and you're listening to WRGW.
My belief in a good God is real.
Lydia Slocum from People Little Horse, and you're listening to WRG.
Thank you. Good evening, folks. I'm your host, Henry Scriven-Young, and welcome back to Exclamation Point Uptime, pure gaming, tunes and news, no cheat codes required here on WRGW District Radio. I'd like to thank everyone who tuned in to the show last Friday, and a special thank you to everyone who has tuned in for tonight's show. For those of you who don't know, Exclamation Point Uptime is a music show where I play the soundtracks from video games. I'll also be throwing in some news and other fun bits, so sit back and relax as we jump in to tonight's show. When hinges creak in doorless chambers, and strange and frightening sounds echo through the halls, whenever candlelights flicker, where the air is deathly still, that is the time when ghosts are present, adding to the terror and scary ambiance of Alone in the Dark. This game, which is ghoulishly described as having a doom jazz soundtrack, is the perfect game to kick off October. Since part of this semester's theme here on Exclamation Point Uptime is remakes, and I always do scary games during October, I thought Alone in the Dark would be the perfect game to kick off scary season. For those unfamiliar with tonight's game, here's a quick rundown. Alone in the Dark is a 2024 survival horror video game developed by Pieces Interactive and published by THQ Nordic. Alone in the Dark is a reimagining of the original 1992 game by the same name. Believe it or not, this is the seventh installment in the Alone in the Dark video game series. The game features a single-player narrative set in the 1930s, where players can choose to play as Private Investigator Edward Carnby or Emily Hartwood, as they make their way through Dorsetto Mansion to uncover the mysteries within. Alone in the Dark features an over-the-shoulder third-person perspective, doing away with the fixed camera angles of the original. The game's environment is filled with items for the players to find, such as ammo, melee weapons, keys, and collectibles like journals and letters that unlock secret information about the story and can even unlock alternate endings. Alone in the Dark was released for PlayStation 5, Windows, and Xbox Series X and S on March 20th, 2024. Upon release, the game received mixed reviews from critics and failed to meet THQ Nordic's parent company's sales expectations, leading to Pieces Interactive's closure in June 2024. With all of that out of the way, let's get back to the music. Mm-hmm. welcome back to exclamation point uptime. That was I Need to Find My Uncle, Johnny the Conqueror, and the New Orleans Doom Shuffle. This soundtrack is really, 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 really great. And one of the things that I really like about it is that it uses, like I've mentioned at the top of the show, it uses this doom jazz. And what it really does well is it pairs well with this noir style, right? So you've got this, like, detective, like, think, like, old black and white, like, detective movie, right? Like, that's the noir style. So you've got noir and doom jazz, and they kind of meld together to create this kind of soundtrack that is scary in a way that makes you want to continue turning corners, that makes you want to continue listening to the music, because who knows what clue you're going to uncover next, no matter how frightening it is, right? Here we have a piece of music with very little music, actually. This is mostly one instrument playing a melody with other things, right? Percussion, piano over it. What makes this scary is how quiet and how slow it is, right? You know, in the story, the two characters, the detective and Emily Hartwood, are making their way to the mansion. They're at the gates, but oh, it's locked. The house is locked. How do they get in? They have to look for an alternate way in, right? Who knows? It's scary. What is going to happen, right? What does Dorsetto Mansion truly have in store for these characters? And how bad is the Hartwood curse? Then you move into Johnny the Conqueror and the New Orleans Doom Shuffle, which in Johnny the Conqueror, I love the tension and the scariness, right? What makes this scary? Minor key, slow tempo. There's kind of a wind effect in the background. It has an overlapping of harp and cymbals. I also really like the oral effects that they add in here, right? There's the like animal sounds in the background, a little like whispering of the wind. I really like it. And it's something that I really like about this soundtrack because it really draws you into that story. Even not playing the game, not having it open right in front of me, I still feel a little scared, right? It's supposed to be spooky, and it is. In the New Orleans Doom Shuffle, you really get to feel that kind of blues noir vibe. The snaps are a cool added background effect. And like I was saying earlier, it's really impressive how much can be done with so little music. The sheet metal kind of effect, like rolling thunder in the background, is neat. And, of course, the saxophone, gotta love it, sounds good. Before we move on to our next section of music, I'd like to talk about our sponsor for today's episode of Exclamation Point Uptime. This episode of Exclamation Point Uptime is sponsored by Generic Theater Company. Always generic, never bland. The award-winning Generic Theater Company, founded in 1985, is George Washington University's largest and oldest student theater company. Each year, Generic produces a variety of shows, from straight plays to musicals, including the annual Freshman Showcase, which has shows in the West Hall Black Box Theater tomorrow, October 5th, at 7 and 10 p.m. No experience is necessary. If you have questions or would like to be involved, you can join the Engage or contact the official email at generictheaterco@gmail.com. Again, that's GENERICTHEATRECO@gmail.com. Would you like to sponsor Exclamation Point Uptime? Well, each week I'll shout out, as I just did, a GW student organization. You can sponsor Exclamation Point Uptime by submitting the sponsorship form found on the Exclamation Point Uptime website at sites.google.com/view/uptime-wrgw. Or you can head to my Instagram account, where I have that website linked throughout my profile. And a reminder that this is not financially compensated. It's more of a shout-out type of thing to promote student organizations here at GW. Additionally, the Exclamation Point Uptime website has been updated since our last show, so I encourage all of you to take a look and explore the website while we take a quick break.
Hello, peasants.
You're listening to WRGW.
Oh, great. Now you tell me.
Where there's always lots of fun.
Are you kidding?
And great music.
Lies and slander.
Tune in at gwradio.com.
Would you kindly shut your noise hole?
Fire and brimstone coming down from the skies. Rivers and seas boiling.
The dead rising from the grave.
Real wrath of God type stuff.
WRGW.
GWRadio.com, Washington.
Human sacrifice, dogs and cats living together, mass hysteria.
WRGW, Washington.
Please come again.
Make the sound we broadcast as loud as possible. Turn up the volume on your receiver as high as it can go. Radio is not a mistake.
It's cool, baby! It's cool!
WRGW, Washington.
Hi, I'm Kate Nash, and you're listening to WRGW District Radio.
WRGW District Radio. Tune in all day and every day at GWRadio.com.
Thank you.
Welcome back to Exclamation Point Uptime here on WRGW District Radio. I'm your host, Henry Scriven-Young, and that was Portrait of a Dark Man, The Vieux Carré, Ambush, That Hateful Mound, and Making Friends. So, obviously I don't love every single piece of music within the soundtrack. Portrait of a Dark Man is one that I'm just not a big fan of. Some of these pieces are just, they're just too quiet. It can help add to the scary ambiance, right? You know, the song's quiet, right? Oh, it's mysterious. But I get pulled out. I lose that immersion when I can't tell if the music is playing or not. Like, at the start of this, I was like, I can't hear anything. Is it going? I think it's going. Sure looks like it's going, and then it kind of built a little bit, and I liked the build. The build was good. It did a good job with the build, but then I'm sitting there going, well, why don't you just start it louder and go and build up to what you built up to, but just make it listenable at the beginning, right? Like, I wish it started at, you know, maybe that was a pianissimo or, you know, very quiet. I wish it started, like, mezzo piano. That would be way better. For the Vieux Carré, it was fine. Like, it was good. It was really nothing to write home about. This one really doesn't do anything special for me, but it does help to continue to portray the story, right? Again, this is all about the immersion, right? You're immersed, right? This song's fine. It's really nothing to write home about, but it does its job. Ambush. This was so good. It's so wonderful. After sitting through the two soundtracks before, which were fine, they were fine, this one was good. Honestly, when it came on, it did scare me a little bit, but that is what scary music should do. I should sit here and every once in a while, I should jump out of my seat because something is scary. That's the whole point. It should have those moments of trying to jump scare you, right? Jump scares and horror is about more than visual. There's this really, really awesome video of this woman at Universal, and she's deaf, and she's signing to the camera, and the captions say something along the lines of, most people don't realize how much horror relies on sound, and this character, Universal, some scary thing, sneaks up behind her and is, like, trying to scare her, but she doesn't notice, because she obviously can't hear him, and she doesn't see him because he's not in her peripheral vision. And so eventually he comes around, and she just kind of, like, waves, and she's more shocked that he was there at this moment, you know, in the video, than she is by him actually trying to scare her. She's not scared, she's shocked, because part of horror is audio. Hearing those, you know, little whispers in the background, hearing the harp, and then the boom, there it is, big sound, the ambush. That's what makes horror music good. Unpredictability. Moving to That Hateful Mound. This one's also really good. I don't know what they're using to imitate the little, like, insect sounds, but they're awesome. And I really like here with the build, and then it goes from loud to immediately quiet. For those of you who don't know music, that's called a sforzando. Basically, it means you get really, really loud in a very short amount of time, and then you slowly kind of, you back off away from that. It's kind of like a burst of energy. And then the last one is Making Friends. This is background music, right? In the game, this is background music under a conversation, but even this piece has so much detail, right? The piano chords are cool. They're crunchy, right? Which is what makes them mysterious. They butt right up against each other. And the drums in the background are, again, they feed into that noir theme. So this soundtrack has great songs. Not all of them are great. Not all of them are going to be awesome. But it goes to show how much detail and how much thought has gone into the soundtrack for this game. A quick note. 4 out of 10. 3.7 out of 5. 6 out of 10. Alone in the Dark may just be the most poorly reviewed and poorly received game that Exclamation Point Uptime has ever covered. As mentioned at the top of the show, Pieces Interactive closed in June of 2024. This closure was, unfortunately, because Alone in the Dark failed to sell the required number of units to make money. It's hard to say why specifically the game failed to interest people, but GameSpot shed some light on the situation, saying the, quote, "Puzzles are very frustrating and feel indecipherable. Combat is underdeveloped and unwieldy, and audio issues persist throughout," end quote. Despite having an interesting storyline and incredible lore, the game just couldn't capture and retain the interest of players. The game does carry a $60 price tag, perhaps that is one of the reasons why so few people purchased the game, so I would suggest watching a playthrough of Alone in the Dark instead of buying the game outright. With that being said, let's move on to some more music. Thank you. And welcome back to exclamation point uptime. I hope you all enjoyed Derceto Revisited, The Conservatory, and The Soft Step of a Gumshoe. These are, again, three pretty honestly good pieces of music. I don't have a ton to say about them. A lot of them are revisiting what I've kind of already touched on. Derceto Revisited is good. I like the quiet ticking in the background. It kind of sounds a little bit like a heartbeat, which is really neat. It's really interesting how they do that. I like the flute in the quiet sections. It's very mysterious. And this piece has much more of kind of a melodic and musical tone, which I enjoy because it really fits with the story of the game, right? It keeps you immersed. Part of the story here is you've just come out of this weird, like, dream sequence, alternate reality. Was this real? Was this not? And you're back in the house, right? You're revisiting Derceto Mansion. And it's nice because it's like, okay, this is normal-esque. Yeah, I'm using air quotes when I say normal. But it fits with the game, which is nice. The conservatory, very cool effects. I like the swelling of the tension and also the like oral stuff in the background, the like noises, the groans, all of that kind of stuff in the background that adds to the ambiance, which is nice. And then also the soft step of a gumshoe, which finally has more noir. The one thing that if I could add one thing to the soundtrack, if I had like a genie wish, I would add more noir stuff. That's what I would add. Considering you're uncovering the mystery of Derceto, there's not enough of the noir theme in this soundtrack. I love this one. The drums, the soundtrack, the saxophone, the xylophone, everything. It is great. Moving on to news. This past week had a lot of interesting video game news, so we'll jump right into the two stories I have for tonight. Our first story comes from PC Gamer. Nintendo announced a lawsuit against PowWorld developer Pocket Pair. This lawsuit marks the beginning of what is sure to be a long and dramatic court case. IP lawyer and video game patent expert Kirk Sigmon signaled the importance of this case by saying, quote, "Nintendo's playing with fire. If Pocket Pair is able to prove that the claims made by Nintendo's patents are demonstrated in prior art, meaning similar design elements had already existed in other games, then Nintendo wouldn't just lose its lawsuit, it could lose its patent entirely. This is a critical moment in Nintendo's patent battles, and could mark the end of its patent dominancy in the video game world." Exclamation point Uptime will cover this story as it progresses. Our second story is from Polygon. Creating a great open-world game is really, really hard. Few series have done it successfully, but those that have were rewarded for their efforts. Unfortunately, Star Wars Outlaws has come up short. With much anticipation over its release, the game simply takes too much time to be interesting. With progress tied to an Ocean's 11-style heist plan, which involves recruiting the experts needed to break back into the same vault from the intro of the game, it's easy to understand why folks have pushed back on the game. Polygon reporter Todd Harper makes her frustrations clear by saying, quote, "The elements of something great are all here. As it is now, the result is a game that tries to do so much that it simply doesn't have the time, energy, or resources to fully succeed at." End quote. And that's the news for this week. As we move into the last 10 minutes of the show here, I want to talk about recordings. So I am recording tonight's show. You can expect recordings to be posted the same week as the Exclamation Point Uptime show. For example, I plan to upload this episode sometime this upcoming weekend. If you would like to listen to Exclamation Point Uptime's last episode, Squirrel with a Gun, you can find the recording on my YouTube channel and the Exclamation Point Uptime website. Speaking of the website, be sure to fill out the special guest form, sponsorship form, and the show idea submission form, which can be found on the Exclamation Point Uptime website. A reminder that this episode of Exclamation Point Uptime is sponsored by Generic Theater Company. Always generic, never bland. The award-winning Generic Theater Company, founded in 1985, is George Washington University's largest and oldest student theater company. Generic produces a variety of shows, including the annual Freshman Showcase, which has shows in the West Hall Black Box Theater tomorrow on October 5th at 7 and 10 p.m. If you have questions or would like to be involved, you can join via Engage or contact the official email at generictheaterco@gmail.com. Would you like to submit your student org for a sponsorship? Well, check out the Exclamation Point Uptime website. Form to submit is at sites.google.com/view/uptime-wrgw. I'd like to thank you all for listening in to tonight's episode of Exclamation Point Uptime on WRGW District Radio. I'm your host, Henry Scriven-Young, and I'll see everyone next week for Pure Gaming Tunes and News. No cheat codes required. Thank you.
Channel 22.
God, I should take her out right here with these, man.
Stewie, did Mr. Jackson behave inappropriately toward you?
Well, yes, but the worst part was he never called back. No, but in all seriousness, yeah, he was actually pretty aggressive.
GWRadio.com.
Where's the money?
You're listening to WRG.